Welcome to JSTV, a ministry of Joshua Springs Calvary Chapel in beautiful Yucca Valley, California. We'd like to thank you for joining us today for our verse-by-verse study through the Bible with Senior Pastor Jerel Hagerman. We would also like to encourage you to grab your Bible, maybe a cup of coffee, and join us for the service already underway.
Well, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your amazing grace, for the power of the book of Romans. We pray that by your Holy Spirit now, Lord, you'd work in our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'd like to turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 4 is where we are today. Again, Romans chapter 4. The reason we are evangelical Christians is because of Romans chapter 1. A tremendous revelation that started a tremendous revival. The just shall live by faith. Not by works, not by external rituals that we go through, but the just shall live by faith. Say it with me. The just shall live by faith. Then in the rest of Romans chapter 1, Paul writing in Corinth, which was like Las Vegas on steroids as far as debauchery and immorality. He's looking out his window. And as he looks down, he writes Romans chapter 1, the last part, and that downward spiraling. And several things happen in a society that turns its heart away from the Lord. Sexual immorality and deviance becomes the norm. And it's just a destruction of the family. Violence increases. Always when people turn their heart away from the Lord, violence increases. And again, when you look at America today, you see those very things. Now, Romans chapter 2 deals with something that was a major concern for Jesus. In fact, Jesus would tell his disciples, first of all, in other words, something that's really, really important, that you beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. The Lord cannot stand hypocrisy. Play acting, putting on a mask of saying one thing. Meanwhile, you who are pointing fingers are guilty of the very same things that you're pointing fingers at. And he gave that in chapter 2. Romans chapter 3 dealt with the Jewish people because the Jewish people were going, wait a minute, we're God's chosen people. What's in it for us? And Paul writes and he tells them why they were chosen, to be the guardians of the oracles of God, which was the very word of God. And chapter 4 is going to reiterate that we are not saved by works, but by his amazing grace. Let's begin in chapter 1. And he starts with the example of Abraham. What then shall we say? That Abraham our father has found according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something of which to boast, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Now to him who works, the wages are not counted as grace, but as debt. In other words, my friends, if you have a job, and at the end of the week or the end of 2 weeks, whenever you get paid, that's not a gift to you. They're paying you what is owed because you worked for it. And again, the point that Paul is making here, we cannot earn or work for our grace. There is only one way that people are saved, and we're told that in verse number 3. And again, I want you to look at verse number 3 again. Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Say it with me. Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Again, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him as righteousness. Someone would ask Jesus, what is the work that we must do to do the works of God? And Jesus answered in John chapter 6:29, Jesus answered and said, this is the work of God, that you believe in him who he sent, that you believe in Jesus. That's the bottom line. So when Paul uses this as an example, because Abraham is the father of faith, and when we realize that God called Abraham and Sarah to leave Ur of the Chaldees, and he said, I'm going to build a great nation out of you. Now, if I were God and I was going to build a great nation, I would pick a 30-year-old guy and a 20-year-old wife. Not God. God picks a 75-year-old man. I mean, we're about to the end anyway, right? A 65-year-old wife to begin, and he brings them to the promised land. And in Genesis chapter 12, and it's important that we never forget this, because it deals directly with where we live today. God gave a promise to Abraham and Sarah, which would be passed on to the nation. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. And we have to understand anti-Semitism, which is the hatred of the Jews, is demonic in nature. Now, if all you do is watch mainstream news, you have no idea this is happening. But in Israel, Muslim terrorists have set fires all over the land of Israel, and it is on fire now. And again, you won't see that news on CNN because it doesn't fit with the liberal ideology that Islam is a religion of peace. So they're not even going to cover it. You know, one of my favorite parts about the election has been the mainstream media is in a tizzy fit. I mean, because finally the American people have realized that they're not telling us the truth. And so they're all up in it. But where does it say that Abraham believed God? Genesis 15. And I love this because in Genesis 15, verse number 1, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield and your exceeding great reward. Now, Abraham had been promised promises that he hadn't received. And so Abraham questions the Lord. But Abraham said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus, who was one of his servants. Then Abraham said, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir, and that was his servant. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. Thus says the Lord, this one shall not be your heir, but the one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. And I love this part. He brought him outside and said, look now towards the heaven and count the stars if you are able to number them. And he said, so shall your descendants be. And here's the quote that Paul uses. And he believed in the Lord and he accounted it to him for righteousness. Abraham simply believed in the Lord. Now, again, my friends, you look at the natural thing. Abraham's an old man. His wife is past the age of having children. She's already gone through menopause. It doesn't look good, does it? And I want to tell you, in our lives, there are going to be a lot of times where the outlook doesn't look good. When the circumstances in our life, and you know what God said? He took him outside, and we love this because we understand it living here in the high desert. He took him outside, and he said, look up at the stars in the heaven. Can you number the stars? This is how many offspring that you're going to have. And what does the Bible says? Abraham believed God. My friends, how were people in the Old Testament saved? What did they have to do to be saved? Because there is a chapter in the Bible that tells us over and over how people in the Old Testament are saved. It's the same way they're saved in the New Testament, by faith. Hebrews chapter 11 starts with Adam and Eve, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith, by faith. And in our lives, it's only by putting our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that we're saved. It's not by anything we've done. And so he's using Abraham as an example. Now he goes on to David in verse number 5. But to him who does not work but believes on him who justifies the ungodly. Again, do you remember last week? What does the word justify mean? Say it with me. Just as if I'd never done it. Again, just as if I'd never done it. I want you to think in. You know your past. You know the things that you have done. And I want to tell you that when you confess your sin to Jesus, He justifies you. What does that mean? Just as if I'd never done it. He justifies the ungodly, and all are ungodly. In Romans 3, it says, there is none righteous, no, not one. In Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But to him who does not work but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted as righteousness. Now again, there's no need of using these terms if we don't understand what they mean. What does righteousness mean? It simply is this: being right with God. I am right with God. And it says in verse number 6, just as David also describes the blessedness of a man to whom God imputes righteousness apart from works. The word imputes, in fact, all this language here is accounting terms. He accounted it to him as righteousness. He imputes righteousness. Do you know what impute means? It means to put on our account. So he takes away our sin. He makes us just as if I'd never done it. How awesome is that? Then he puts on our account, on our balance sheet, his righteousness. And then he quotes a scripture out of the book of Psalms in Psalm 32. And it says in verse number 7 here in Romans 4, blessed. Blessed, again, we use these terms, we don't even know what they mean. Do you know what blessed literally means? Oh, how happy. Oh, how happy are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin. And again, means put on his account. What's the story in Psalm 32? The story is this. David, in many of the Psalms and in much of David's life, David was running for his life. There were people trying to kill him. And you know what? When people are trying to kill you, you're crying out to God, aren't you? Lord, help. I always say, the prayer that I prayed more than any other prayer, help. One word, help, Lord, help. So David spent much of his life running from the Lord, but now he is the king. Now he lives in a palace in Jerusalem. And if you've ever seen the model or the city of David, at the very top is the temple. This was Mount Moriah. The very next building down was the king's palace. And then the city of David was actually very small on this peninsula that jutted out with a canyon on each side. It had walls on it. The houses were joined together as they went down the hill. So David, in the springtime, when the kings go out to war, David didn't have to go out to war anymore. He'd spent much of his life battling, much of his life running, but now, hey, you know what? It's time to eat, drink, and take ease. And so there he is. He didn't have to get up early in the morning, so evidently he was up on his patio balcony at night. And easily, when you're there, you can see this. The buildings built down, one patio adjoining another, you know, all the way down. David goes out there. He has a clear view of all the roofs. The roofs in Israel were used, and they still are today, as patios, like what we would have, a deck or whatever, because the city was so closely compacted together, they made their roof flat so they could be on it. Well, lo and behold, on this night as he's looking out, there is a beautiful woman named Bathsheba taking a bath on the balcony. Now, I have to tell you, I don't think Bathsheba is totally innocent in all of this. She could have put up a curtain, right? But she's taking a bath. She was beautiful, and David sent for her, and he spent the night with her. Eventually, she would send back that she's pregnant. Do you know who her husband was? A friend of David. His loyal commander in his army. You ever been betrayed by a friend in your life, in your journey of life? Well, when David finds out that she's pregnant, he's going to betray his friend deeper. He's going to send word to have this commander brought back. He'll chit-chat about the battle and what's going on, and he'll send him home. He'll go home, sleep with his wife. He'll be none the wiser. His wife has a baby. He'll never suspect that it wasn't his. Only thing, Uriah was one of those soldiers that had great integrity. And he said, why should I get to enjoy my wife when my men are out in the field? They don't get to have that privilege. So he slept in the doorway of the palace, and King David was told about it. So the next night he came up with a plan. This time I'll get him drunk. But the problem is, Uriah is more righteous drunk than David is sober. And so he still doesn't do it, and now David's got a problem. And I want to tell you, when you let sin go in your life, it always gets worse. So David writes out orders for Uriah to be put at the front of the battle. All the other soldiers are to withdraw, that Uriah is killed. So Uriah, unbeknownst to him, holding a scroll that the king himself has sealed for his commander, has his own death warrant, and that's exactly what happens. Now, David is the king, so he can do whatever he wants to do. He takes Bathsheba as his wife. Life goes on in the palace. But I want to tell you, if you are a believer, you cannot get by with unconfessed sin. If you can sin successfully, you're not his. That's what the scriptures declare. So one day, Nathan the prophet comes in. And again, this is hypocrisy. Nathan the prophet comes in. He tells him, hey, there's a guy in your kingdom that has one little ewe lamb. He's raised this from a baby. It drinks out of his cup. There's a rich guy in your kingdom that has all kinds of herds and flocks. The rich guy has someone come over. He takes the poor man's ewe lamb and makes a barbecue out of it for his guests. And David is furious and leaps to his feet. That man deserves to die. Deserves to die for stealing a lamb. You, David, stole your friend's wife and then had your friend murdered. You're the man. Now, I want to tell you something. God gives David the name, a man after God's own heart. It wasn't because he was such a great person. It's because when David was confronted with his sin, there was an unconditional surrender. And David writes Psalm 32, blessed. Again, what does blessed mean? Oh, how happy. And I want to tell you, David isn't, oh, how happy that I have power and I'm the king. David is not writing, oh, how happy because I'm so popular. They even wrote songs about David. He's not saying, oh, how happy because I have male prowess. He's not saying, oh, how happy because I have prosperity, because he had all those things. And yet he was not happy. And listen to what he writes. Blessed, oh, how happy is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, in whose spirit there is no guile. When I kept silent, my bones grew old, and through my groaning all day long, for day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was turned into the drought of summer, Selah. I acknowledge my sin to you and my iniquity I've not hidden. And then I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. That word iniquity could also be translated the guilt. You forgive the guilt of my sin. In our physical bodies, God has made us that there is pain in our body when something is not right. When there's something not right in our body, there's a warning sign, and that is pain. For our spirits, God has done the same thing. That warning sign is a guilty conscience. We know when we're right and when we're wrong. And there is absolutely nothing that is hidden from God. And although David was a king and could do whatever, he's telling us here, for that year he lived miserably and he was dying inside because he knew that there was sin in his life and there wasn't happiness and there wasn't blessedness in his life until he confessed his sin. So before we go on, my friends, in today's message, I want to give you that opportunity. First of all, there is nothing, not a thought or an intent of the heart that you can hide from God, let alone a word or a deed. The Lord knows all things. But I want to tell you, how then can we be saved? It's by believing in Jesus Christ, who willingly paid the price on the cross. I deserve to die. I'm guilty. There isn't anything I could do to undo. I'm guilty. But when I believe and I confess my sin, he justifies me. What does that mean? Just as if I'd never done it. Then he puts on my account, not my righteousness, his righteousness gets put on my balance sheet. And you know what that makes me? Oh, how happy. And so I want to give every person here an opportunity to be, oh, how happy, right this moment. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, I do believe. I know you're the Savior of the world, that you died upon the cross. But Lord, I want to confess my sin. I know there's nothing hidden from you. And in the quietness of this moment, in my heart, I'm going to confess my sin to you. Pray with me. And now, Lord Jesus, I thank you for your forgiveness. And I truly want to repent. And I want to follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name. Now, my friends, you know how this story ends with David? After he's confronted with the prophet Nathan, and he accepts all the consequences. And let me tell you, there are serious consequences that there'll be in David's life. But I want to tell you, from this union, David and Bathsheba, they're going to have yet another son. We're getting into the Christmas season. And in Matthew's gospel in chapter 1, there are four women who are named. Now, there's generations that go down, and there's a begot. I want to tell you, for every begot, there had to be a woman. You ain't begotten nobody without a woman, all right? But there are four women that are mentioned, and one of them, this is how it says. This is the bloodline of Jesus. This is the line through which Mary would be born. This is the very blood that Jesus would have, would come through a son, and this is how it's described, the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Aren't you glad Uriah never got forgotten? Aren't you glad in the midst of his friend betraying him and taking his wife and taking his life? No matter how bad people mess up their lives, and mess up their families, there is redemption in the power of Jesus Christ as we believe in him. Amen? Now the scripture goes on in the book of Romans. In verse number 9, we're coming back to Abraham. Does this blessedness then come upon the circumcised only, or in other words, the Jews only, or upon the uncircumcised also? For we say that faith was accounted to Abraham for righteousness. How then was it accounted? While he was circumcised or uncircumcised? Not while circumcised, but by uncircumcised. And he received the sign of circumcision, the seal of righteousness of faith, which he had while he was still uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all those who believe, though they are uncircumcised, that righteousness might be imputed to them also. The father of the circumcision, to those who are not only of the circumcision, but also those who walk in the steps of faith, which our father Abraham, while he was still uncircumcised. So it's a little bit complicated as you're reading here, but basically Paul's asking a very simple question. When Abraham, it was accounted to him to be righteous, was he circumcised or uncircumcised? And the answer is, he was uncircumcised. That happened in Genesis chapter 15. It wasn't until Genesis 17, at the age of 99, that God asked Abraham to be circumcised. Now, you know what? That's pretty private, and that's pretty intimate, isn't it? And the reality was, it was always to be a spiritual truth that Deuteronomy would say this. Therefore, circumcise, in Deuteronomy 10:16, therefore circumcise the foreskin of your heart and be stiff-necked no longer. In other words, stop being rebellious. Start wanting to do what the Lord wants you to do. In the book of Colossians, in chapter 2, it says in verse number 11, in him you were also circumcised with a circumcision, listen, made without hands. We're not talking about physical act here. We're talking about a spiritual one. By the putting off the body of the sins of the flesh, by the circumcision of Christ. Buried with him in baptism, in which you were raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. And you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he is made alive together with him, having forgiven all the trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of the requirements that was against us, which is contrary to us. And he has taken it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them. So again, here's the point. We have a covenant of God that isn't dependent on a human mark. We have a covenant of God that is dependent on our heart wanting to do what the Lord wants us to do, and to be stiff-necked no longer, to live in the flesh no longer. Now, I used this example last week, but I want to reiterate it because it is something we can understand. I made a covenant with Marilee. We stood on this stage. We covenanted before each other and to God that we would be husband and wife. That we would be faithful to one another, that it'd be for, well, for us, it was better or better. I went back and fixed it, better or worse, rich or poor, you know, the whole routine. At the end of that covenant, we exchanged rings. Marilee put on a ring and I put on a ring. So I have a ring that is a sign of my marriage covenant. Now, if I were to lose my ring, would I still be married? I'd still be a married man, right? Whether I have the external sign of it or not, why am I still a married man? Because it's a covenant of the heart. And so, with that, a person can wear a wedding ring and commit adultery, and they break the covenant because they have broken the very words and the heart that God has laid out. Does that make sense? So I can lose my ring. It doesn't change the fact. It's my heart. People can wear a wedding ring and break their covenant by their actions. So that's exactly how it is with our relationship with the Lord. And that's exactly what the Apostle Paul is saying here. No external rituals are going to save you. My friends, does it do you any good to be water baptized if you're not a believer? If all it took was getting you wet, we turn on the sprinklers every week. If that's all it took, and for some of you, we'd have to hold you under a lot longer, you know? But the reality is none of that means anything without the heart. Now, when your heart is right, then baptism's a powerful thing. It was an outward declaration of what other people see of what has taken place inside of our heart. Now, it goes on in Romans 4:13 to say, for the promise that he would be heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law. In fact, it would be another 400 years before the law was given, but through righteousness of faith. For if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void, and the promise is made no effect. Because the law brings about wrath, for where there is no law, there is no transgression. Let me give you an example. In Europe, on the Autobahn, there is no speed limit. So you know what that means? You can't get a ticket for going too fast because there is no speed limit. You can only get a speeding ticket when there is a sign that tells you the speed limit is X number of miles an hour, of which we all want to break by 4.9 tenths of a mile per hour, so that we really don't want to obey the laws. Isn't it funny? Don't touch wet paint. What do? We go touch it, see whether it's wet paint. We had it in the gym here. You know, we painted the floor. Don't touch. Don't come in. You know what I did when I came in? I touched the floor, see whether it was wet. You know, it was dry. Don't worry. My fingerprints aren't on it. In verse 16, therefore is of faith, so that it might be according to grace, so that the promise may be sure to all the seed, not only to those who are of the law, but to those who are of faith of Abraham, who is a father of us all. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. Now, my friends, this also is very interesting because we read that in Genesis 17. You know, Abraham's name, Abram was his name before God changed it, means exalted father. But you know what the problem was? Abraham was 99 years old. He didn't have this promised nation. His wife Sarai was 89 years old by now. And God looks at him and says, I have made you a father of many nations. You know why? Because in the Lord there is no time. He's the God who is to come. There is no time and realm in all things. That's why he can simply speak something because he knows that it's going to be. So he speaks to Abraham as though it has already happened. I have made you a father of many nations in the presence of him who believed, even God who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. Genesis 18, the Lord is there. Sarah's eavesdropping. She's not in the tent where the Lord and Abraham are talking, but her ear is next to the tent and she's listening in. And the Lord tells Abraham that in a year, Sarah is going to have a baby. You know what Sarah does? She laughs. And then the Lord said, why did Sarah laugh? And then she lied. So she laughed and she lied. No, I didn't laugh. Yeah, you did. And here's the thing. The Lord says this. Is there anything too hard for God? Say it with me. Is there anything too hard for God? Is there anything too hard for God? Is there anything too hard for God? My friends, God calls us to believe even when the circumstances are bleak. I want to tell you an elephant story from Barnum and Bailey Circus. Biggest elephant they had was Jumbo. Jumbo could uproot a tree. That's the power that Jumbo had. But Jumbo was a wonderful, gigantic creature and did all kinds of special tricks and is amazing. Now, if you have an elephant that could uproot a tree, how are you going to tie him up? You know what Jumbo was tied up with? A 12-inch stake. And they tied Jumbo up to that 12-inch stake. Jumbo never pulled that 12-inch stake out. You know why? Because when he was a tiny little elephant, baby elephant, he was tied up to that stake and he couldn't get out. He spent the rest of his life thinking he couldn't get out from that 12-inch little stake. And my friends, I think so often that's how we are. We don't realize, do we serve a great God? Do we serve a God? Is there anything too hard for our God? And my friends, we limit by our lack of faith what God can do. And the scripture goes on to say that God who calls to life the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. And in verse 18, who contrary to hope in hope believed. I want you to say that. I love this. This is my favorite verse out of this chapter. Who contrary to hope in hope believed. Say it. Who contrary to hope in hope believed. Again, who contrary to hope in hope believed. Again, who contrary to hope in hope believed. Again, who contrary to hope in hope believed. Because, my friends, we live in a fallen world. And we live in a world where there's a lot of pain and sorrow and tears and crying and mourning. But I want to tell you, we have faith. And we believe in a God in whom there is nothing too hard for God. So we entrust our lives to Him. Have you ever thought, this day could not get any worse? And it does. Have you ever had days like that? Oh, it can't get any worse. Yes, it can get worse. Have you ever woke up going, what bad thing is going to happen today? I've had such a string of bad things. What bad thing is going to happen today? And again, I want you to look. Abraham, 99 years old. His wife is 89 years old. Is there any hope of them having a baby? Can they just go out and have a baby? If they could have had a baby, they would have had a baby a long time ago, like 50 years ago, right? And at this point, there is no hope. It's past that point of hope. And this is what we have to understand, my friends. There is nothing too hard for the Lord, and our life is in His hands. And whatever we have to face in life, it's up to Him. The scripture goes on to say, who contrary to hope in hope believed, so that he became the father of many nations, according to what was spoken, so shall your descendants be. And not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead, since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb, which he was decades past menopause in her life. He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief. Underline that verse. And especially underline unbelief. He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief. But I want to ask you a question. Did Abraham ever waver? Did they ever waver? What about that chapter 16 of Genesis? The whole story of Hagar? You know, Marilee and I taught a marriage retreat once, and we were teaching this part. And, you know, I was teaching the part about Hagar. Marilee had everyone in, or Abraham, Marilee was teaching the part about Sarah telling Abraham to go into, Hagar, which was a common thing. I want to tell you, that's how surrogate parenting was in those days. And Marilee goes, oh, right. Abraham, I tell him all kinds of things. He never listens, you know. I tell him to go into my maidservant, Johnny at the spot, you know. He's right there. The reality is this. It was a failure, wasn't it? Wasn't it taking thing into their own hands? But I want to tell you, it was not through unbelief. They never stopped believing in God and His plan for their life? Did they make mistakes? Did they laugh? Did they think, how can this be? But it was never because they did not believe in God. And it goes on. He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully convinced that He had promised what He was able to perform. And in verse 22, and therefore, repeating where we started, it was accounted to him for righteousness because he believed. Now, it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him, but also to us. And it shall be imputed, put on our account, to us who believe in him who raised Jesus, our Lord, from the dead, and who was delivered for our offenses and was raised for our justification. The last place I want to take you in the scriptures is Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place he would afterwards receive as an inheritance. He went out not knowing where he's going. Was Abraham's journey perfect? In fact, when they got to the promised land, there was a famine going on. Do you remember? They went down to Egypt instead of seeking the Lord, and Sarai at 65 was such a babe that he knew that Pharaoh would want her for his harem, so he said, hey, say that you're my sister. That wouldn't even be the entire time. Is that recorded for us here in Hebrews 11? No, it's just by faith that they went. The next thing it says, by faith he sojourned in the land of promise as a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. We're still waiting for that city. It is the New Jerusalem. There's only one city in the Bible that has foundation. It is the New Jerusalem that we read in Revelation. By faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she judged him past the age, because she had judged him faithful who had promised. But did Sarah ever laugh? Did Sarah ever lie? Was Sarah perfect? No, but you know what she did? She believed. And she believed that God could do whatever he said. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were as born as many as the stars in the sky in multitude, innumerable as the sand on the seashore. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them from afar off and were assured of them and embraced them and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. My friends, I want to ask you a question. Are we ever going to face things in our life that we do not understand? Are we ever going to face something in our life that we go, how can God work any good out of this? What good could possibly come from this event in my life? Do you believe that your life is the Lord's? You see, my friends, here's where people get in trouble. Jesus would say this, you try to hang on to your life, you're going to lose it. If you're selfish and you're self-centered, I want to tell you, you're always going to have a miserable life, and eventually in all things, you're going to blame God. But Jesus would say this, if you deny yourself, take up your cross, he's going to give us life and life more, what? Abundantly. So we have to realize something. You know, when people are kids, they think the whole universe revolves around them. No, the universe does not revolve around them, do they? That's why when they graduate from high school, we give them luggage. Okay? Go make your own way. It doesn't revolve around us. I want to ask you a question. What if God's will for my life is going through a trial that really doesn't even have anything to do with me, but maybe will bring somebody else to the Lord? Am I willing to allow him to do that in my life? My wife's husband, Brent, time after time would share the Lord with his dad. He wanted to see his dad saved. And I'm happy to tell you he's saved today. He's looking forward to going to heaven. You know when he got saved? At Brent's celebration of life. We have no idea whatever can happen in our life. But you know what we can do? We can believe. We can follow him regardless of what we're ever going to have to face in life. I love Paul's scripture that he would write when he was told by prophets of God, here's your future. Chains, tribulation, and death. This is your future. And Paul would say this, none of these things move me, nor do I count my life as dear to myself, that I may finish my race with joy in the ministry I've received to testify to the gospel of his grace. Does it mean, my friends, that all of us are going to be perfect all the time? Are there going to be chapters in our life where there's failures? There are. But you know what it means? Jesus Christ has paid the price. And he has justified me. And I want to follow him all the days of my life. And I only have to do one thing. Believe. And you know what's going to happen? We win. Not one problem goes to heaven with you. And did you notice something in the Hebrews 11? Only the victories were recorded. None of them other chapters, they're all left out. Only the victories are recorded. You know why? Because our Lord has justified us. Amen? Let's stand. Lord, this is such a powerful chapter. Lord, there's deep things and sometimes even confusing things as we read terms that sometimes we fully don't understand. But we thank you for the power of your forgiveness in our lives and the power to believe. We thank you for the examples of men and women of faith. We thank you, Lord, that you didn't shield us from their failures. We thank you, Lord, that they did make it, and they believed. And Lord, you fulfilled the promises in their life, some of which couldn't be fully fulfilled until they were already with you. And we thank you, Lord, that that's our lives as well. You fulfill every single promise in our life because there's nothing too hard for you. So today, Lord, we declare it's our heart, it's our life. We believe in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Our God.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Thanks again for tuning in. We hope you enjoyed this week's message. If you would like to contact us, you can contact us at www.joshuasprings.org, or you can give us a call at 760-365-0769. Hope to see you next week, and God bless you.